Hey y'all, my name is Prashanth Kumar, or PK, and I'm an MCAT tutor at Shemmassian Academic Consulting. Today, we're going to be tackling five discrete questions from the MCAT Chem Phys section. You should be taking roughly a minute for each of these questions, but today, we're going to be going more in depth so you can see exactly what's going on in my head as I tackle this section. Make sure to like and subscribe down below, and comment exactly what types of videos and content you're looking forward to on the YouTube channel next. Let's get it. All right, so I've gone ahead and put all five questions that we're going through right here, so feel free to take a moment and pause the video and come back to us when you're ready. I'll go ahead and zoom in on the question so you guys get a better look. And with that, take a moment and pause the video. Awesome. So let's go ahead and talk strategies for these discrete questions. I really, really like the discrete questions because they're a little more fast-paced. They're a nice break from all the passage questions. You don't have to read anything other than the question itself. So it's very, very much, let's get it right away. So with that, we want to be a little quicker on these questions. We don't want to waste too much time. And if you need to, flag them, come back to them, but don't waste too much time on that first sort of look at it. All right, so let's get right into question number one. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle states that which of the following cannot be measured simultaneously? Is it A, velocity and acceleration, B, position and displacement, C, acceleration and composition, or D, velocity and position? All right, so right away, this is a question that is asking us about information we should know right from our head. And what is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle talking about, right? That's what the question's asking. It's asking about a specific principle that we should know when we're talking about small particles, right? Usually we talk about it when we're dealing with electrons. We can also talk about it when we're dealing with photons, but small particles is what I like to describe the Heisenberg principle with. And so the principle is specifically talking about velocity and position. So D is our answer right away. We shouldn't even need to think about A, B, or C because we should have the understanding that the Heisenberg uncertainty principle is dealing with velocity and position. But let's make sure we understand the principle. The idea is that these small particles are moving pretty fast and are not in one place constantly. So as soon as we start learning more information about one thing, we're losing information about the other. So let's say we have this little point right here that we're looking at. The point is our position, right? And we're going to draw another line indicating the direction it's moving. The idea is, as soon as we start zooming in on the point, right, the position, it's going to move to a different location. And then we're going to have to start looking at this, but then all of a sudden, it moves to another location. So as soon as we start looking more and more at position, we're losing information about where the velocity will take us. And so we zoom in, we lose information about velocity, and if we zoom in on velocity, we're gonna lose information about position. Remember, velocity is related to two different points at two different times. So the change in distance over the change in time, right? So as long as we understand, if we're focusing on one position, we lose information about the other position. And so that results in losing information about velocity. So right away, Heisenberg uncertainty principle, one or the other, velocity or position. You gain more information, you lose more information about the other. So right away, we're one for one. And remember, these are quick questions, so we're going to take our time as needed, but we're going to go a little bit quicker through these. All right, question number two. Researchers carry out a reaction and determine the presence of two products. Product one both forms and degrades quickly, whereas product two both forms and degrades slowly. Which of the following best describes product one and product two respectively? Is A, kinetic-kinetic, B, thermodynamic-thermodynamic, C, kinetic-thermodynamic, or D, thermodynamic or kinetic? All right, so right away we're describing a certain type of product, right? And so we're talking about two different types of products, so this requires prior definition. So we're specifically looking at labeling product one and product two with these terms kinetic or thermodynamic. So let's make sure we understand these two terms. So first, let's talk about kinetic, okay? When I think of kinetic, I think motion. When I think kinetic, I think motion. And so right away, motion is talking about speed, okay? And so for me, that's how I associate it. So the kinetic product will form faster, but be less stable, okay? So form faster, less stable. That's very, very important understanding. So just because it forms quickly, it'll degrade quickly too, right? whereas the thermodynamic one, I think of thermodynamic as thermos, like a thermos. It's really stable, rugged, right? And so it might take a lot of time to form, but it's going to be much more stable as compared to the kinetic product. So this one's going to form slower and be more stable, okay? So the two differentiating factors are the speed at which it forms as well as the stability of them, okay? So right away from these two definitions, we should be able to analyze what product one and product two are. So if it forms and degrades quickly, right, as product one does, we're dealing with the kinetic product. If it forms slowly and degrades slowly, it forms slowly, makes sense that it's thermodynamic. If it degrades slowly, it's more stable. So we're gonna put two there. So our answer is going to be kinetic and thermodynamic, C, right? So right away, if we know one is kinetic, we can eliminate B and D, and then we eliminate A by saying the second one's thermodynamic. Awesome, we're 2 for 2. Question number 3. A mouse in group 3 is given 50 milligrams of oxaliplatin. If the half-life of the drug is 6 hours, how much will remain in the mouse at 24 hours? Is it A, 12.5 milligrams, B, 6.25 milligrams, C, 3.125 milligrams, or D, 1.562 milligrams? All right, so this is a common type of question we'll see on MCAT day. It's a half-life question. You pretty much guaranteed to see one. Because it's a common quick calculation based question. Okay, so 50 milligrams of oxaliplatin and the half-life is 6 hours, right? And so we need to understand what half-life means, right? Half-life means after this period of time, right? After blank time, we're gonna have half as much, right? That's the idea. We're gonna have half as much quantity after that period of time. So in this case, after 6 hours, we'll have half of whatever we started with, that original amount. So in this case, we're gonna draw a little diagram, okay, to help us think. So we're gonna start at time zero. All right, T0, we have 50 milligrams. So after 6 hours, we should have half of 50 milligrams, which is what? 25 milligrams, right? So that's one half-life. But how many half-lives are we dealing with? In 24 hours, how many times is 6 hours in there? And that's 4 times, right? That's 4 half-lives that are occurring. So after 6 hours, we're at 25 milligrams. After 12 hours, how much would be left? Half times 25, right? Which is equal to 12.5 milligrams, okay? After 18 hours, that's our third half-life. We're gonna half times 12.5, and what are we left with? 6.25 milligrams, okay? And then after 24 hours, which is what our question is asking, right? We're halving 6.25 milligrams, and we're going to 3.125 milligrams. Awesome. So this is where we look, and we see that matches C, and we can eliminate D, B, or A. And you might be like, PK, I can't do math like this. This is very, very quick. Not a lot of time, a lot of calculations, right? I don't really care about the decimals for you, right? Look at these four numbers, 12, 6, 3, and 1, right? We should be able to differentiate pretty easily after we do those calculations. 12 and 6 are not close to each other. 6 and 3 are not too close to each other. 3 and 1, maybe a little iffy, but not too close to each other, right? So even if we just focus on ignoring the decimals, right? We ignore the 6, the 0.25 and the 0.5, right? What's half of 50? 25. What's half of 25? Roughly 12. What's half of 12? Roughly 6. What's half of 6? Roughly 3. Okay? And so we get to that answer after doing very, very like shallow mathematics. And while it's not perfect, in this case, it doesn't matter. We're able to distinguish. And if we're able to distinguish faster, that'll save time on MCAT day. So don't be scared of the math. Try to take shortcuts within reason. And so this is one like type of shortcut I like to use is don't be scared of the decimals, because at the end of the day, they should be a little further apart. And we can go right on to question number 4. Question number 4. A researcher sets up a simple series circuit with a single resistor. Over time, the resistance of the resistor decreases. Which of the following best describes the effect of decreasing resistance on a current, given constant voltage? All right, so this is a type of question where we're having to understand the relationship of variables, okay? And usually when I think of these types of relationships, especially as it relates to resistors, as it relates to voltage, as it relates to current, right? These terms that we see, there should be, like, you should be having alarms be ringing in your head, right? We have resistance, voltage, and current. What's the most common formula we'll probably use when dealing with this? Ohm's law, right? V equals IR. And so V is equal to voltage, right? Oops. Voltage. I is equal to current. And R is equal to resistance. If I can spell, resistance. And so this is a common law we're going to use over and over again. So make sure you have this in your head. And so now we're looking at the relationship between these three variables, right? We have some sort of circuit. We are looking at what happens when the resistor decreases, right? Given a constant voltage. So that's what it's saying. Equal voltage, but decreasing resistance. And what are we looking at? We're looking at what happens to I, okay? So sometimes I have different ways I like to do this. Sometimes I just put what's happening over the variables, and it should make sense. For some people that works, some people that doesn't. So let's try that first. V equals IR. So if I draw an equal sign here, right above it, and I say I'm decreasing resistance, if I decrease something and it's multiplied together, I'd have to increase something else, right? I have to increase something else to counter that decrease. And so that makes sense in my head. But for a lot of people, that's a little too abstract. So let's look at a different way, right? Let's input numbers, okay? So if I say we have 10 volts, right? And then we have, just put two numbers that work. So 5 and 2, okay? 10 equals 5 times 2. Makes sense. All right, so if I set this as equal, right? 10 is staying the same. What happens when we decrease R? So let's say from 2, we go to 1. So 10 equals question times 1. Well, 10 equals 1 times 10, right? So this 5 turns into 10. So you see an increase in that variable, right? So there's a lot of different ways to think of this. It's all about relationships. As you decrease one variable, you have to increase the other to make sure they're equal. And so I like sometimes plugging in numbers if I'm not too sure about it, if there's too many variables. But sometimes you can just think about it with this equation. So here we saw, okay, if we decrease one variable, that means we increase the other variable, okay? And so with that, we're able to pick our answer as A, right? Current will increase if we decrease resistance at a fixed voltage. Awesome. Now on to question number 5. Great. Which of the following is the ideal gas law? PE equals MGH, F equals MA, PV equals NRT, V equals IR. All right, hopefully you've seen this in general chemistry, organic chemistry, every sort of physics class. PV equals NRT, ideal gas law. That is should be one of the things that you remember very, very well, okay? So right away, we should be able to pick this out as C as our answer. But let's make sure we understand the other ones, right? The MCAT is a fixed pool of knowledge, and we want to make sure we know all these formulas by name if we need to pull them out. So right away, we just talked about D. V equals IR is Ohm's law. Okay? Let's talk about B now. F equals MA. This should be ringing bells in your head. It is Newton's second law, right? Probably one of the most famous physics laws as we're dealing with relative motion, all of that type of stuff, right? F net equals MA. All right, A, PE equals MGH. Not really a common formula name for this one, but this is the formula for gravitational potential energy, okay? So GPE equals MGH. And so these formulas are ones you're going to work with when you're calculating values. But sometimes it's really helpful to know the names for the formulas just in case they ask a question like this on test day. All right, great work, y'all. We crushed 5 discrete questions from the Chem Phys section. Kudos for you for getting it done, and hopefully that helped learning types of equations, half-life, different types of products. So much great content. Hopefully that was helpful. If you like this video, give us a like down below and subscribe to our channel, and comment exactly what types of videos you're looking forward to next on the YouTube channel. Additionally, check out our 528 strategy series from Vikram. Super, super helpful strategies from everything, each section, so much great stuff. And finally, click the link in our bio to sign up for the MCAT question of the day. Happy studying, and let's get it.